Harper Audio presents The Bitch is Back, Older, Wiser, and Getting Happier. Edited by Cathi Hanauer. Performed by Teri Schnaubelt. But now I know the things I know, and do the things I do. And if you do not like me so, to hell, my love, with you. Dorothy Parker. Truth is the only safe ground to stand on. Elizabeth Cady Stanton. Introduction. About 10 years ago, while on a paperback tour for my second novel, Sweet Ruin, I slid into my assigned aisle airplane seat and immediately became aware of the couple next to me in the window and middle spots. I'll call them Jack and Jill. Both were tall, blonde, and attractive, if, like me, approaching middle age. He had the telltale extra pound or two in the gut. Her face was slightly creased. Nonetheless, they had the distinct aura of 2 16-year-olds newly in love. He teased, she giggled. He leaned over her to look out the window. Her hand rested on his arm. As I sat, apparently on one part of his seatbelt, he made a joke to me, but clearly for her benefit, about my not thinking him rude if he retrieved it. She laughed, he joked again, this time to her. Hey, it was your idea for me to sit in the middle. I joked back to them. You guys want me to go somewhere else so you can have some privacy here? They both laughed. Yeah, would you? And since the flight was packed and I couldn't actually move, we were off to a promising start for a writer always on the hunt for a good story. By the time we landed, I had theirs. Jill was heading into her mid-40s, as I too was then. Unlike me, though, she had adult children. I had young ones. 2 young grandchildren and a joyless, stifling, outdated marriage to, as you may have guessed by now, a man other than the one sitting next to her. She wanted to leave, and her husband knew that, and didn't want the same, but so far they hadn't divorced. Jack, too, was in an unhappy marriage. His wife hadn't wanted to have sex with him for years, though sometimes she did anyway, and he had cheated on her before. They had, he said, a don't ask, don't tell policy. Like Jill, he wanted to leave, but he had a 10-year-old son and didn't want to miss out on his son's childhood or pay alimony, especially when he'd funded his wife going back to school and, now graduated, she still hadn't returned to work. Jack and Jill had met through their jobs. One thing had led to another, and now they were enmeshed in a full-blown affair, taking every chance they had to flee or hide out together. They spoke wistfully about when they might be with each other openly. She confessed that she cried sometimes when they parted, deciding she'd have to end this, as it was too hard to always have to say goodbye. While they talked to me, they each ordered a drink from the cart, and then another, lowering the shade against the bright sun. Uninvited, she sloppily poured his beer into his plastic cup with about 3 inches of foam on the top, and they both cracked up, giddy with alcohol and lust, no doubt imagining the fun they'd have this week away from their spouses. At the end of the flight, I wished them good luck, and they promised to email and fill me in on what happened. Which they did. More about them in a bit. Several years before that, just about 15 years ago now, I conceived and eventually edited a book of essays called The Bitch in the House, 26 Women Tell the Truth About Sex, Solitude, Work, Motherhood, and Marriage. The contributors ranged in age from 24 to 76, but the bulk of the book, and what ultimately made it a bestseller and propelled me, to my amusement, into a person who can walk into my local bookstore and have the employees gleefully yell, "The bitch is in the house!" were the essays by my then 30-something female peers, women juggling serious careers, careers in which they often significantly out-earned their boyfriends or husbands, while still, they felt, shouldering the bulk of the domestic, social, and parenting burden. The overriding tone of the book was anger and dissatisfaction. Feminism, I posited, had opened the doors for the women of my generation to be educated and have careers on a level with men, to support ourselves and climb job ladders in our 20s, to fully anticipate fulfilling and lucrative professions in which we contributed a comparable or superior share of the family income, and to have the help, once we married and especially had children, of an equal domestic partner and co-parent in all of it. We picked sensitive, intelligent men who accepted and benefited from us as peers, intellectually, financially, and otherwise. But when the babies arrived, whether because they couldn't, because they wouldn't, and or because society or we ourselves wouldn't let them, many of these men were not contributing what we working women perceived as their half. As a result, we were exhausted, disillusioned, resentful, and angry at our husbands. We felt guilty at work and guilty at home, and much preferred sleep to sex. We were tired of juggling and running ourselves ragged, but there seemed to be no other way, with families that now relied on our income, careers that defined us, and few role models for how to do it all, we had no choice but to carry on. And so we did, but often not as graciously or contentedly as we wanted to or felt we should. We were the bitch in the house, the opposite of the angel in the house, made famous by Virginia Woolf in a speech, a woman so selflessly devoted to her children and husband that if there was chicken for dinner, she took the lesser pieces for herself. If there was a draft in the room, she sat in it. And, as I learned from the response to the book, there were a lot of us bitches out there. I published The Bitch in the House in 2002 and rode that wave for a while. And then I wrote and published the aforementioned second novel, Sweet Ruin, the story of a suburban couple with a young daughter in which the wife commits adultery. I call it my midlife crisis novel. And as time passed, as my own kids grew up and our family had a steadier income and life calmed down, and I became, for the most part, much less angry, I began to think about doing a sequel to Bitch, something to reflect what happens later, after those frantic, demanding, exhausting years with work and very young kids and, sometimes, not enough money. But I wasn't sure exactly what it should be, so I filed away the idea. Which brings me back to Jack and Jill on that plane, who I met during those relatively calm, less bitchy years. Their story didn't shock or surprise me. In fact, it was like a play-by-play slice of at least some of what I was seeing, hearing, and inferring around me at that time. The very night before, the mostly female audience of 30 and early 40-somethings at the bookstore where I'd read from Sweet Ruin had, not atypically, vented the pent-up fears and frustrations they'd hidden and harbored for weeks, months, or years. "My husband cheated," said one. "I cheated," said another. "I want to cheat," said a third. "My husband and I rarely, almost never, never have sex. I hate my husband. My husband hates me. Marriage sucks." "You think so? Me too." Yes, this was a room full of people who came to a reading of a novel about adultery, but still. Back at home, in my admittedly progressive alternative town, even as someone well aware of the latest bleak marriage stats, not to mention someone who realizes that alternative communities like this one often fare worse with traditional institutions, I'd still been struck by the number of families in which the couple was now splitting up. Though close to 90% of Americans are still projected to marry at some point and for some duration, an increasing number of women are postponing marriage, if not foregoing it altogether. American marriage is at a record low, with, for the first time ever, the number of single women surpassing the number of married ones, 51% versus 49%. Of the couples who do marry, 43% will divorce, 75% of those will remarry, and of those, 68% will divorce again. 40% of American children now born to married or cohabitating parents will see these parents break up by the time they're 15. My sister, an economist, points out to me that if you looked at only the college-educated, you'd get very different statistics. Nonetheless, unmarried mothers now have some 40% of the country's babies, With an increasing number of these mothers, college-educated women in their 30s, 40s, and 50s. And late-life divorce, also called silver or gray divorce, has become increasingly common, with people 50 and older now twice as likely to divorce as in 1990, and rates even higher among those over 65. 60% of divorces after age 40 are initiated by women. Among my neighbors and peers and the parents of my children's classmates and friends, I was witnessing separations, affairs, divorces, flux and rebellion and disarray, almost all of it in that not-so-sweet spot of early midlife. I was also seeing the setting up of alternative arrangements, from separated couples nesting, taking turns living at the house so that the kids don't have to move back and forth, to lesbians raising their new partners, ex-partners, biological kids. That, it seemed to me, had been virtually unheard of even a decade before. I saw formerly gay women hooking up with men, formerly straight women going for other women, baffled men left in the dust, often with joint or more custody of the children. Some of us, of course, were still solidly married. More married couples than not, after all, stay together for better and worse. But among my non-local friends, I saw more of the same flux I had seen here in crunchy Northampton, Massachusetts, affectionately nicknamed the lesbian capital of the world. Where the coffee is strong and so are the women, reads a favorite local slogan. Elsewhere, one close friend had recently left her 12-year-long marriage and was now living happily with a much younger man. Four of my 40-something female friends or acquaintances were having or had recently had affairs, two discovered by their husbands, both of whom wanted the women to stay, two, so far, not, two of the marriages ending, the others so far continuing. Another female friend, who was her family's primary wage earner, as are most of my close friends, was miserable in her marriage, which she felt was unloving and unfair. She wanted out, but couldn't see how to escape, with a consuming full-time job, a young son, and barely time to think, let alone initiate, pay for, and carry out a divorce. On a recent date with a very social friend, I'll call her Aphrodite so you remember her later, I told her my observations. She, in turn, told me first about her own struggling marriage, and then about those of others she knew. Maybe, Aphrodite concluded, the problem isn't all of us, but marriage. Maybe we're all brainwashed to believe this is what we should be doing, when in fact, marriage has outgrown its usefulness and now leads to more misery than happiness. As if to echo her thoughts, galleys of soon-to-be-published books began to arrive at my door. As a writer, I am often sent books for review or endorsement that bluntly stated the same thing. First came The Marriage Go-Round, The State of Marriage and the Family in America Today, in which the author, Johns Hopkins sociology and public policy professor Andrew J. Cherlin, wrote, "What we have witnessed over the past half century is, at its core, the unprecedented decline of marriage as the only acceptable arrangement for having sexual relations and for raising children," adding, "In the space of a half century, then, we have seen the widest pendulum swing in family life in American history." Then came the hilarious and bitter The Superior Wife Syndrome, in which author Karen Rubenstein, who holds a PhD in social personality psychology from New York University, posited, "The fact that Americans view marriage as dispensable and no longer compulsory indicates that radical changes are taking place within the culture." Magazines and the news media also trumpeted the trend. A New York Times Magazine cover story featuring communities of women raising children together without husbands, two kids plus zero husbands equals family, it was titled, with the subtitle, "Many college-educated single mothers are setting up lives around other single mothers and all their children, with no role for men or romance," appeared just 1 week after the magazine's cover story, "What is Female Desire?", in which one of the article's main experts concluded that it's wrong to think that because relationships are what women choose, They're the primary source of women's sexual desire, and within long-term relationships, women are more likely than men to lose interest in sex. In her Atlantic essay, Let's Call the Whole Thing Off, writer and comedian Sandra Singh Lowe described her decision, after having had an affair, to end her 20-year marriage.
Given my We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.